Well, we are so glad that everybody is here this evening, and welcome to the 8th Annual Hall of Champions Banquet. Tonight is really a very special night for Long Beach City College because we're really able to say welcome home to 8 outstanding competitors and supporters of Long Beach City College. In addition, we're going to collectively recognize and honor 6 individuals who we've identified as our emeritus inductees. I know that as this evening unfolds, I guarantee that this gymnasium is going to come alive with the Viking spirit that all of you remember so well. You're going to be feeling really good because you're going to hear stories from the past. You're going to hear about plays that were made. And I'm not quite sure how everybody remembers these plays when they can't quite remember what they had for lunch. But they do remember these outstanding plays and friendships that they build at Long Beach City College. So welcome. We're glad you joined us. Not all inductees were able to join us this evening, but the vast majority of our inductees are here, and we're very thankful for their attendance. To begin this evening, we want to direct your attention to the northwest corner of the gym, so we can welcome those honorees and family representatives who could attend as they take their seats. We like to call this our Parade of Champions. So let's start with our emeritus group of inductees. Please welcome a 2-sport athlete with outstanding accolades in both football and track between the years of 1957 and 1959, Henry Andrews. Here's another football and track athlete who shared the same fields with Henry. Please welcome Mickey Byers. An outstanding performer on our 1948 and 1950 football teams was John Callard. Representing him tonight is his wife Barbara and his 2 sons, Chris and Jeff. Please welcome these 3 representatives of the Callard family. Now joining us from the 1954 and 1955 track and field teams, an outstanding performer with both the shot put and the discus, please welcome Bob Humphreys. Our final emeritus inductee represents the sport of basketball. A little later, you'll hear something very unique which connects this individual to the community in this facility. Please welcome Bob Seymour. Run the court, Bob? Aren't you going to run the court? Okay. All right. The rest of our honorees are those individuals who attended and competed at Long Beach City College in a more recent time frame and will be officially inducted tonight. Let's now meet this group. Someone who cannot be with us tonight, but we do need to acknowledge, please give a round of applause for an outstanding athlete of our 1968 and 1969 baseball teams, Ed Crosby. And someone who is here with us and someone who broke several records during his competitive days, please welcome our next honoree, representing track and field, Kerry Hardwick. Now entering the gymnasium, please welcome an outstanding athlete who succeeded on many levels for the sport of volleyball, Jack Hinton. Welcome, Jack. playing for us during the 1992 and 1993 softball seasons, an award-winning softball pitcher. Please welcome Nikki Kephart Trimble. Our next inductee had an outstanding career as a two-sport athlete over several years in both football and track. Please welcome Ernie McBride Jr. Can you still hurdle one of these tables, Ernie? All right. The next inductee entering the gymnasium is an outstanding two-sport athlete, representing the sports of football and baseball, Ron Drake. There seems to be a theme going on here tonight with two-sport athletes, but I guess when you got talent, right? Please welcome our next inductee representing both basketball and volleyball, Laura Fetzner-Castro. And our final inductee, an outstanding football and volleyball coach, one who has coached on both the local and international levels, the guy we all consider the coach's coach, Gary Jake Jacobson. That's our parade of champions. Is this room full of talent or what? Someone earlier talked about this being one of the events in Long Beach that really brings out the history and traditions of Long Beach. And I would dare any city in the nation to have this kind of camaraderie and this kind of talent all in one room. This is a very special night, and we're glad you're here. There is a slight change in your program this evening, and I want to bring it to your attention. Our superintendent president, Eloy Oakley, was called away at the last minute and was unable to join us, but he really hates to miss this event because he says this is one of the favorite ones of the year for him. And he made me promise that I would tell everybody in the room that he's sorry he's not here and give his best wishes, knowing that tonight would be another great event. So I do want to extend his best wishes. Fortunately, though, we have a great individual to replace him. Mr. Mark Bowen serves as the vice president of our Long Beach Community College District Board of Trustees, and he represents Area 3 in the city of Long Beach. And as we all know, any board, whether it be at the high school level, the community college level, plays a very important role in that they set the direction and monitor the district's activities to assure that the citizens they represent are properly educated, engaged, and empowered. Our board members have always been very supportive of the area of athletics and physical education, and Mark is no exception. That's very much appreciated. So to officially greet you this evening, please welcome our Board of Trustees Vice President, Mark Bowen.
Good evening. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I welcome you all to the 8th Annual Induction Ceremony for the Long Beach City College Hall of Champions. Our athletic tradition over the past 80 years has been outstanding. It has included 14 national titles, 76 state titles, and 14 bowl appearances. And our current staff is working very hard to see that this great tradition is continuing. Just 2 years ago, the LBCC athletic program was recognized as the number one athletic program nationally by the National Association of Two-Year Colleges. Yes. Furthermore, Our athletic program is instrumental in carrying out one of the key goals that was passed by the Board of Trustees 2 years ago, and that is the institutional goal of student success through the development of the Student Athlete Success Center. This center helps to support the academic needs of our student athletes. And I think we need to be especially thankful to the taxpaying public of this community for the overwhelming support that they continue to show for this institution. The bond measure that they passed last year is going to help to renovate our facilities and see to it that this outstanding tradition that our athletic program has enjoyed in the past 80 years is going to continue well into the future. And that said, without further ado, I hereby welcome back all the former Vikings and their families who are being honored tonight and inducted into the Hall of Champions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Very much appreciated. I'd now like to invite Bill Barnes to the podium to deliver this evening's invocation. The Hawk, as he is known to some of us, is a member of the class of 2007 inductees to our Hall of Champions, both for his basketball skills and for his longtime support as an administrator here at Long Beach City College. Not only is Bill a good man, he's a good friend of mine, and he remains a very loyal friend to Long Beach City College. Bill?
Good evening. Let us pray. Almighty God, once again we come to you with humility and gratefulness. Humility because we are imperfect, and yet you provide for us. Gratefulness because once again we have a special occasion to honor extraordinary athletes. Athletes who have enhanced their natural gifts with dedication, with the support of family, coaches, teammates, in our community. We're grateful and we hope that we reflect that understanding of your grace by the way we conduct ourselves. Bless this food to our bodies and us to the service. We ask that all in the name of the Almighty. Amen.
Our meal this evening is being provided by Chura Venue Services, and the owner, Jim Chura, was a former Long Beach City College student and also a former Long Beach Unified School District board member. And Jim continues to take very good care of us. He personally sponsored a major portion of this meal this evening, and I just want to publicly thank him. Also, another thing I'd like to point out is that the individuals who will be serving you this evening are all our current student athletes. These are the young women that we work so hard for through our fundraising efforts to support. So I hope that while they're serving you tonight, you might have a few words with them, ask what sport they're in, and give them a couple encouraging words so they can have the same success that everybody sitting around this table has had. So now please not only enjoy your meal, but the great company around you. We'll talk to you after dinner. And we hope you enjoyed your meal. And the other thing that I'd like to do again, because I hope everybody took an opportunity to do what I asked you to do, and that was to talk a little bit and thank some of our student athletes. I've got most of them lined up there right against that back curtain, so I hope everybody would just thank them again for all their great service. This is why we're here, and a lot of those students who waited on you are just outstanding athletes, and they are setting records today. They're doing great in the classroom, and many and most of them are going to transfer just like everybody else did. So thanks again, everybody. We appreciate your help. Just a little word of caution for others who are going to get on the mic tonight. As you notice, this microphone doesn't quite pick up the sound. So especially for our tall basketball players, if you have to, take it out of here and put it right up next to your mouth. That way everybody in the room is going to get a chance to hear all the great words we're going to say tonight. Okay? They're great. Now, I'd like to move on with just a couple introductions and acknowledgments, if I can. And one of the things, as the Dean of the School of Physical Education and Athletics, it's always a pleasure to be connected with a group of colleagues who work hard every day and truly understand what everybody in this room understands, the concept of teamwork. I'd like to introduce a few of them to you. I know one who a lot of you had phone contact with, and I sure hope she's back there. Where's Christy Fuentes? Christy, thank you for all you've done, and thanks for keeping track of all the numbers and money and everything else. We appreciate it. Two staff members checked everybody in, but I'd be really remiss if I didn't acknowledge them. First, I want to thank Sharon Raven, who had to leave, but Sharon's one who's going to retire next month, and she's got that very important job of checking all our athletic eligibility, making sure that people can get on the fields and courts every contest because they're ready to play and academically eligible, so I wanted to thank her. And I also wanted to thank Jackie Olson, simply put, as she's the best administrative assistant at this college, so we're blessed for both of those individuals. In addition, I want to thank the Banquet Planning Committee. A number of them are here with you this evening. And these are volunteers who assisted in getting things set up. And I'd like them to stand and be recognized if they would. I know Camille Bolton's here, Fred Ross Manick, Jerome Thomas, Blake McIntosh, Danny Toe, Steve Wheeler, our student worker, Robert Garcia on the spot. Thanks, Robert. And the rest of the staff members who contributed to the setup and conduct of tonight's event. So I apologize if I missed anybody, but I just want you to know you're not going unnoticed. And later, I know that Chuck McFerrin's going to acknowledge some of the other individuals who participated. Now, let me introduce a few of our special guests this evening. You've already met our Vice President of the Board of Trustees, Mark Bowen. Thanks again for being here, Mark. And I'd like to introduce another board member for the Long Beach Community College District Board of Trustees. I know him because I watched him play football at Millikan as a classmate. Would you please stand and be recognized, Doug Otto. And also, I'd like to acknowledge a few of our elected officials who are in attendance tonight. Thanks for joining us. We always appreciate that. A 2003 inductee into our Hall of Champions also just happens to be one of our Long Beach City Council members representing the 6th District, Dee Andrews. Dee, will you stand, please? I know you used to run for the end zone, Dee, and around the track, but you kind of run in a different way now. And I was watching you work the room a little earlier, so the man's still running. A longtime educator and friend of Long Beach City College, who is the current president of the Long Beach Unified School District Board of Trustees, please welcome John Meyer. Thank you, John. And I love this one because every time I get a chance to introduce a former mayor of our city, it's fun for me, and I'd love to have Eunice Sato stand up. Eunice, where are you? Where's Eunice? There you are. Thank you, Eunice. We appreciate you being here. Right over here to my left. You know, I am also very fortunate to work with the very best physical education faculty and athletic staff around. They are a group of caring and very committed individuals who do a great job taking care of our students and our student athletes, and I'd like to acknowledge those who are in attendance. Our department head of physical education, good friend of mine, Will Shaw. Will, please stand. Our men's athletic director, Larry Reisbig. Come on, Larry, we're going to give you a little FaceTime. Stand up again, and Patty, stand with them. They're celebrating their 50th anniversary tonight. That's been a great partnership for many years. All right, behind the magic curtain like the Wizard of Oz, where's Connie Sears, our women's athletic director? She's working the sound system, as always. She does all and does everything. Connie. Great women's athletic director. Thank you. Chris Ruiz, our sports information officer, I know is here in attendance. Chris, where are you? Does a great job of pub. There he is. Stand up. great job of publicizing our events. You might want to get on our athletic website. He updates all the scores daily, and it's a nice thing to see. And all of our current faculty, coaches, would you please stand as a group? I'd like to have anybody who's currently teaching in our faculty or currently coaching, please stand. Come on. Mike Reisbig, Mike Maloney, Jerry Jaso. Who else we have? Susie Whitmer. We've got Bridget Richard, Donna Prindle, and Gary. I want to be one right here tonight, be one of the first of many to say thank you for all you've done. Thank you, Gary. Gary Anderson. And also, I know a few of my fellow members of the Long Beach Century Club are in attendance tonight, and that's a group, if you don't know, has over 50 years of existence in the city whose sole purpose in Long Beach is to support amateur athletics. They raise funds, they help high school students, they help college students, and it's a great organization. So would any members of the Long Beach Century Club please stand to be recognized? John Cashuabara, Bill Stewart, got Susie Atwood, got Jeff Severson, saw Sam Demas, a few of them are here. So thank you very much. And as long as I'm giving plugs, because that's kind of really what I'm doing right now, Long Beach City College has its annual golf tournament this year. I think it's our 27th annual golf tournament. That serves as one of our major fundraisers. And if any of you have Thursday, May 14th free, stop by and see me afterwards. We'll tell you a little bit more about how you can get involved. This is, again, the major activity that helps all of our student athletes. That particular event takes place under the auspices of our foundation. And as long as I'm talking about the foundation, I've saved a couple introductions to now, because I want to acknowledge the support that that office has given our athletic fundraising efforts over the year. So in attendance tonight, representing the foundation, is the executive director, Dr. Virginia Baxter. And the assistant director, Dana Walsh. Please stand, Dana. You know, the main goal of the Hall of Champions is really to raise awareness about the fine athletic traditions from Long Beach City College. But to foster this awareness and grow the hall, you know, fundraising does have to take place. So you may have noticed out in the hall or in your program tonight some people who have given at various levels. And we'd like to encourage those of you who would like to do that to continue to do so. We have lots of work to do. We want to expand the hall. We want to get new banners. We have lots of things we'd like to do. So on page 2 and 3, I think, of your program, something like that, shows those various levels. And if you have interest in that, you might want to contact Larry, Connie, Chuck, Ginny, Dana, or any of our coaches, and we can tell you ways you can get more involved. We can use your support. And that's enough of the paid commercial announcements. I do have one final short introduction before we introduce our Hall of Champions and induct them, and allows me to get off the stage. And that's Chuck McFerrin. And approximately 10 years ago, our Hall of Champions was just kind of a concept. It was something we all knew we needed to foster, because the tradition of excellence in athletics is just as good as it can be in this city. And most of them have come out of Long Beach City. They've crossed our paths. And we needed to honor all of these former student athletes and coaches. And at that time, Chuck was the men's athletic director. And under his leadership, this talk that we had going kind of turned into action. And tonight is really one of the nice legacies that Chuck left before he retired. We won't let him get away, though, because we keep him involved every year. He's nice enough to volunteer his time and keep this thing going. And we really appreciate it. His expertise and commitment and continued leadership really helps us. So this is the 8th annual ceremony, and we're glad Chuck is still here to do what he does best, and that's to champion athletics and honor athletes. And I'd like to invite him to the podium now, if he would, to present and install the class of 2009 of our Long Beach City College Hall of Champions. Chuck?
Started to sound like a memorial service. Well, I want to welcome everybody. Thanks for being here. It's always a special night, I think, for this college and for the city of Long Beach. The people that we honor tonight have made sacrifices in the past, have given of themselves to further the image of this college, and we appreciate that. We hope that you had an opportunity in the reception to browse around and look at the banners up on the walls. Look up in the kind of higher in the ceiling. We've got our Olympic wall, all of our people who are Olympians, either coaches or athletes. The names of all of our state and national championship coaches are up there on plaques. And there's quite a few of them because Long Beach City College has more state and national championships than any other California community college. So we're proud of that. Well, this room is full of legends, and great memories will be revealed tonight. It's another great group of inductees. I'd like to recognize those that selected our inductees, and so if you'll turn with me to, they're not numbered, but like around page 4 or 5, Hall of Champions Selection Committee, and I'd like the people, when I call your name, to rise, hold your applause, and we'll applaud at the end. Bill Barnes, Margaret Boss, John Philpaw, Jerry Jaso, Joe Lanning, Bob Myers, Donna Prindle, Larry Reisbig, Bridget Richard, Will Shaw, Connie Sears, Jeff Smith, Chuck Stewart, Al Verdun, and Susie Whitmer. There's your selection committee for tonight's inductees. I wanted to say a few words about the focus tonight, obviously, is a lot on the past, but I wanted to say a lot about what's going on currently. This is an alive college, still a viable and strong athletic history is being developed. Many of the people that were waiters tonight could be candidates to be an inductee down the road, and I thought they did a great job tonight serving your meals. Since our last banquet, I'm going to just hit a few of the highlights of what's happened since last spring and this past last fall. There are 19 athletic teams, men's and women's. 16 of the 19 made it into post-conference play, passed on and made it on into the playoffs. We had women's water polo, took second in the state. Men's water polo and men's volleyball were final four teams. Men's track and field was fourth in the state. They had a 110-meter hurdle champion, a state champion, and a javelin champion. Men's and women's swimming team each had some All-Americans. Women's tennis, they won the conference championship in singles and doubles. We had a softball pitcher who led the state in strikeouts and set a new LBCC career record. One of the Trimble records has fallen, and we'll talk about that later. And women's track had a fourth place finisher in the 1500 meters. So some great performances, and it just kind of keeps moving on. So I wanted to just not focus on the past, but know that it's still a happening thing going on at the college. We now want to go through our emeritus inductees. And let me just quickly explain. This college, obviously, you know, started in 1927. Well, it's hard to go back that far and really induct people from that long ago and keep up with your more current athletes. And so we created a category, did it about 3 or 4 years ago, was the first induction, in which we set a standard of somebody had competed 50 or more years ago, or if they were deceased, that they were eligible to be inducted as an emeritus inductee. And so we had a ceremony a month ago, February the 20th, a luncheon that was held in the Hall of Champions in which those individuals were inducted. And their plaques were out there on the board with the inductees that are coming in tonight. So that's kind of the history of how the emeritus inductees got started. They received the same plaque awards and the other things that go along with being an inductee. It's just an opportunity, really, to more easily include those who have been away from the scene for quite a few years. 50 years is a long time to have thought about competing. So I want to quickly have these people introduced, and when I call your name, have you stand and be recognized. I'm going to start off with Bob Seymour. Bob's in the back of the room. Stay standing, Bob, please. Stay standing. Bob was our captain in 51. He was the second highest scorer on a team that won the Metro and was a state finalist team. He went on from City and played at Long Beach State. In junior year there, he was their leading scorer and MVP. He was their team captain in his senior year and their leading rebounder. He was a teacher coach in Long Beach for 31 years, junior high schools. I knew that we had four past inductees who were in under his tutelage in junior high school. It was Dan Peters and Dave Frost and Bob Sivertlik and Ed Crosby. They're all people that were under his leadership when they were junior high school. And Kerry Hardwick and Jack Hinton are also in that same category. So we have like six people who were in our Hall of Champions that developed themselves under Bob's leadership in junior high school. Very special award he got in 1988. He was the recipient of the Long Beach Centennial Sports Award, only one of 26 people. It was the first 100 years, and they evaluated people who had contributed to the city of Long Beach. Contributions to sports in Long Beach first century, and Bob was one of those individuals. And then you're pretty special when they name the gymnasium at the middle school that you worked at after you, so they call it the Bob Seymour Gym now at Stanford Middle School. But there is a special thing that we want to do tonight for Bob. Bob, if you come forward, this is, I know, going to be a surprise to you. On your way up, I'm going to explain kind of how this award, special award tonight, germinated. At our emeritus... Just come on up, Bob. At our emeritus luncheon, Bob told the story of how, when this gym was built in 1952, they couldn't start that 51-52 season because the gym wasn't ready when the season began. So on January 26, 1952, they played their first game in this building. Bob scored the first point in this gym in January 26, 1952. A couple of years ago, we had to replace the floor because the nails were showing through. You couldn't sand it anymore. This plaque is made out of the floor of this gym, and I think it even has a piece of the free throw line on it, which he said came out of the West End in a game in which they beat Harbor College 58-45. So, Bob, congratulations. Our next emeritus inductee is no longer with us, and it's really too bad because it would have been a great pleasure to have him here speaking or at the luncheon. John Callard, who was a football player here in 48 and on the 50 team. His wife, Barbara, is here. Barbara, you want to stand in recognition of John? Let me say a few things about your husband. He was on our all-conference team in 48. He was the starting halfback on the national championship team in 1950. He set the LBCC record for most yards in a season and most PATs. He was the Junior Rose Bowl most valuable player in 1950. He was an all-Southern California player, and he went from City College on to Denver University, where he made all-Skyline Conference. Then went on into the Marine Corps and played in a lot of activities in the Marine Corps and the Navy All-Star teams. He became a high school coach and math teacher. For many years, he was at Rancho Alamitos in Garden Grove as the head football coach. and he won 7 championships in the 10 years that he was the head coach over there. And he was at the end of his career, he was also, or maybe during that same period, he was a math teacher for 17 years at Saddleback College. So he took his skills from Long Beach City College and from Denver University and took it into the classroom to benefit an awful lot of youth. So Barbara, congratulations on John's behalf. Those first two recipients were from Pauley High School, and so is our next one, Henry Andrews. Henry, stand please. Henry played football and track in 57 through 59. He became our 6th all-time single-season rusher in 1958. Think about that. The college had been playing football for 31 years, and he had risen to being the 6th on the all-time list as a rusher. He was the Alfalfa Bowl Most Valuable Player in 58. He set a Long Beach City College long jump record of 23 feet plus, and he was a championship. And then after his playing days here, he was very active in the City of Carson Parks and Recreation League. And it was very interesting. At the emeritus ceremony, there was a city councilman, I believe he was, came over and presented Henry with a very nice City of Carson proclamation honoring him for his service to the city and the good deeds he had done. And he's also part of the a little bit of history in that he and his brother D, who will stand at the moment, are the first brother act to be inducted into the Long Beach City College Hall of Champions. Thanks, Henry. More FaceTime, D. Dwayne Baptiste could not be with us. I mean, nobody from his family could be with us. Dwayne is deceased, and he is someone that his sister was at the emeritus ceremony. He was our top scoring player from 1949 through 49 and 50, and he had done that after overcoming polio as a young man. He was our most valuable player in 50, all-conference that year. He rose to be 5th in the all-time in career points, went on to play at San Jose State, and led that team to an NC2A playoff in 51, and coached the Long Beach AAU team. So Dwayne Baptiste, we have recognized. Our next inductee, Mickey Byers. Please stand, Mickey. Mickey's a Wilson High School Bruin. He was football and track, 57 to 59. He was in the backfield with Henry. They were the two halfbacks together, and they've remained friends over the years. Mickey was the 6th all-time single-season receiver, the 7th all-time season rusher. Again, after 31 years, he had succeeded to pretty good heights. He made one of the junior college All-American teams. He was the City College and the Metro Conference pole vault record setter of over 14 feet, and that's with the old poles, not the launchers that they have today. A very successful businessman, owner in Long Beach. Congratulations, Mickey. Our last inductee has such tremendous credentials and qualifications. We wanted to honor him for 2 or 3, 4 years, but we didn't know really where he was, and that was more our fault than his, obviously. And finally we decided we just don't know anything about Bob, but we're going to put him in. And so we went ahead with it, and we were at our ceremony, and up came one of his high school classmates and said, "Well, I know where Bob Humphreys is. He lives in Camarillo." And so then we made contact, and we've been talking on the phone. It's been a pleasurable experience to just visit back and forth. And so Bob didn't get his moment in the spotlight that day at the luncheon, so we're going to allow Bob to come up and say a few words about his memories as an athlete here. Let me say a few things before he gets here. He was twice the City College, he set the Long Beach City College shot put record twice. He broke his own record in his sophomore year. He was a discus conference champion. He was the shot put conference champion. He went to Wichita State with Mel Patton, who was the coach here, and then took him with him to Wichita State. He was the Missouri Valley Conference shot put champion. In 1962, he had, I think it was a matter of maybe a few weeks or something like that, he had the second longest ever in the world discus throw at 203 feet 5 inches. He won a gold medal in the discus in the Pan American Games in 1963. And then a real surprise was to find out that actually Bhutan Ben Agajanian stumbled across him somehow, and he ended up trying out, and he ended up being a place kicker for the NFL Denver Broncos for 2 years. That'll win you a trivia bet right there. So, Bob, if you'll come forward, give you your opportunity to share with the group.
Thanks for that good introduction. I really just want to thank the foundation for creating the Hall of Champions, and I really feel honored to be a part of that. I lived in Long Beach for my first 35 years of my life, and I was raised just a few miles from here over in Bixby Knolls. I went all through the Long Beach school system, Longfellow, Hughes, and then Jordan High School, and then Long Beach City College. I was adopted when I was 2 1/2 and had good parents and had a rather strict upbringing, as a lot of my friends know. But I was raised in a Christian environment where our home was centered pretty much around biblical principles. And I'm thankful for that. That faith and those principles live with me today. Joining me tonight are my wife and several of my friends. Appreciate you folks coming out. One friend is 50 years of, as a track friend, and another friend, Dwayne, is a 55-year-old friend of from high school, and my longest time friend for 65 years, my friend Bob. We met when we were 5 years old and have remained friends all these years. My first experience with organized athletics was at Jordan High School as a junior. Believe it or not, I was on the tennis team. And I used to walk from those of you who are familiar with that campus, used to walk from the tennis courts to the gym, and you had to go across the track, and the shot putters would be out there working out as I was finishing up with my tennis and walking back to the gym. So being competitive, I had to toss the thing a few times myself, and I couldn't beat them, but I was, I was pretty close. So the next year, I had to make a decision. I went out and we went out for the track team, and Coach Clem Reese was my coach, and that was my first try at the track. The next year, I came to Long Beach City College to enroll, and I remember in those years you had to meet with a counselor in order to get your fall semester plan and your four semester plan to get an AA, which I was fortunate enough to get. I don't know if I passed math, but I sure was. I kept my mind active playing hearts in the quad at the with some of my folks here tonight. So we did a lot of that, didn't we, Paul? So I waited a few minutes for my counselor to come out, and out walks this tall, thin man, and he said, "I'm your counselor. My name is Mel Patton, and I'm the track coach here." So I was really impressed with that because I had never met him, but Mel was recognized as the world's fastest sprinter, holding the world record in the 100 and 200 yards, or meters, I should say, and was Olympic gold medal champion at London in 1948. So, but before we finished, he made sure that I was in his fall track class, and I'd be going out for track in the spring. So, Mel was very instrumental in the foundation of my throwing career. He not only helped with the techniques my event, but he stressed commitment and passion and hard work and to set realistic goals. And those ideals have led me in success not only in athletics, but in my work life as a business owner in the steel industry. Mel was not a real wordy guy when it came to interview. I got to tell a story about one of the writers for the Press-Telegram, John Dixon, was a track and field writer, and he had an appointment to meet Mel and do an interview. And he said to Mel, he said, being a sprinter and holding world's records, obviously it's easy to coach your sprinters and your runners, but what do you do with a guy like Humphreys over here, a thrower? So Mel just looked him straight in the eye and said, I just call one of my Olympic teammates or a world record holder and pass that on to Bob. End of interview. I do want to introduce one man at our table. He's already been mentioned, but Harry Nelson was a teammate of mine on that track team. Harry was a Canadian, came down here to train under Coach Patton and set school records in the 100 and 200, 220 of 9.6 and 20.8. Then a few years following, he improved those marks to 9.4 and 20.4, which were world-class marks. Would you stand, Harry, would you? Please. Good, thank you. In 1957, Joe Lanning was the track coach here, and he invited me to assist him in the track team that year and to work with his throwers. And I really appreciated that invitation and accepted it and had a good year at it. Thank you, Joe. Joe's with us tonight. The next few years, I just continued to train and continue to throw for a track club in hopes of making a national or Olympic team. And one day after a local track meet, a gentleman walked up to me. His name was Moose Thompson, and he was a Long Beach resident, and he said he would like to offer to coach me. And he had really good credentials. He was a teammate of Mel's at SC and also a teammate on that Olympic team in 1948. And he won the gold medal in the shot put in 1948. And Moose, I'd like you to stand for just a second so they can see an Olympic champion. With Moose's help, I continued to improve in both the throwing events, and I was especially proud that both of my best marks came here in the city of Long Beach at track meets here. At age 30, I decided to discontinue competing seriously, and that next year I coached a couple of boys in the shot. This has to do with the Ben Agajanian thing, but I was helping them, and they were also kickers on their high school team. So after we'd throw, they'd go over and practice their kicking. So again, being competitive, I said, I got to try that. So I worked out with them a few times, and their dad came to me and said, seriously, Bobby, says, you kick the ball really well. I think you should get somebody to look at you. So this gentleman knew Ben Agajanian, and he was the kicking coach for the Cowboys, and Ben agreed to come down. So we went to Long Beach State and kicked for about 15 or 20 minutes. And when we came back, I was borrowing the kids' shoes, and I gave them back to him. And Ben said, do you have a pair of football kicking shoes? And I said, no, sir, I don't. He said, I think you better get down to Proctor's Sporting Goods and pick up a pair of Riddell shoes as quick as you can. So that was a real encouragement for me. I played a few semi-pro games that year just to get some field experience because I'd never had a football uniform on prior to that. So I played for the semi-pro team. We wrote a few letters and got a quick response from the Denver Broncos. And they flew me back for a 3-day tryout. And after 3 days, the director of player personnel came up to me and said, Bob, Coach Saban wants you to kick Sunday against the San Diego Chargers. So I signed a contract as a 31-year-old rookie and spent a couple of years there in 67 and 68. I just want to thank the foundation for the recognition that they've given me and these other athletes that you're honoring tonight. And I thank all of you for attending and supporting us and for letting us share a little bit with you about our time here and a little bit about our time after here. Thank you.
Moose, you have something to say? Okay. Let's go.
Now, Moose just mentioned Ben Agajanian was famous for, he was about a 10 or 15 year kicker in the NFL. And he was famous for kicking the ball off and, like a golfer, picking up his tee and walking over to the bench and not caring about the game itself. So one day My coach came to me when I was at Denver and said, Bob, we can't afford for you to stay back with a safety. You're going to have to go down and attract a player and make it a fair game. So, boy, I got on the phone. I called Ben. I said, Coach wants me to go down on kickoffs. What do I do? So Ben says, all you do, you keep moving. He says, you don't stand around or jog. So I kicked the ball off, and the guy ran it back to about the 20 and got tackled. And next week, when we looked at the game films, we could see the pile of tacklers and the ball carrier on the ground. And here's Bob running right by this pile. I went all the way to the goal line.
Well, all that talk about track makes me think of an individual in the room that I want to introduce. He is the founder of what we're doing here tonight at El Camino College, and a good friend of mine who started and has run many years the El Camino College Athletic Hall of Fame. Ray Southstone, would you please rise and be recognized? Thank you. Great. We have 27 past inductees with us tonight, and I'm going to call their names. Hold your applause till we're all done. So when I call your name, if you'd please rise and just remain standing. I'll start with our class of 2002, Susie Atwood, Greg Harris. Hold your applause, please. And Joyce Hicks is going to stand for Joe Hicks. Class of 2003, Dee Andrews, Ron Crawford, Jeff Smith, Jim Stanglin. Class of 04, Dave Frost, Joe Lanning. Class of 05, Lisa Lawrence, John Meyer on behalf of Cliffy Meyer, Bob Myers, Jeff Severson, Robbie Stewart, Tom Amberry, Ed Bapkus, Kenny Booker, Margaret Graves, Sam Demas, John Cashwabara, Dave Levy, Dan Peters. Out of the class of 06, 07, Bill Barnes and John Gonzalez. Class of 08, Paul Chafe, Jim Kelsey, and Donna Prendle. 27 of our inductees. Congratulations. Just an overview of our group tonight. Tonight we're inducting our 113th legend. We have 18 coaches, 2 meritorious, and 93 athletes. So at the 82nd year of the college, we have these 113 that we've inducted. You can see that this is a pretty special company of people to be in. This class of 2009 includes 10 people who broke City College records while they were here. 5 conference records were broken by this group. 4 were chosen to all-state teams, 3 were conference MVPs and state MVPs, the best in their sport. 2 players were on USA national teams, 5 people were JC All-Americans, 4 became professional athletes, 1 you've just met was a Pan Am Games gold medalist. Those were our athletes, and our coach, who's being inducted tonight, was responsible for being on a staff, either heading it or as an assistant, for 12 conference championships, 4 state championships, 1 national championship, and was state coach of the year in volleyball 3 times. So we have a group that is full of record setters and accomplishments. I think as a group, let's give them a hand. One thing you can do at your table for me as the banquet proceeds, and then at the end of the banquet, please bring it up to me or somebody that maybe stood by you who's on the committee. If you would be willing to depart with the back page of your cover and write down, think about it through the night, write down somebody or several people that you would like us to consider for Hall of Champions. And if you can put a little contact information, that's all the better. And put down, maybe if you know what the accomplishment was, that would qualify them. You can look in our program on like the fifth page, and you can see our selection criteria. We set a pretty high standard for being considered for the Hall of Champions. But give it some thought and give us some names, some contacts. That's how we keep our list growing and keep finding new people, as we found Bob just this year. Each inductee tonight will be receiving a plaque identical to the plaques that were displayed out in the foyer for their own personal use, and they will receive a proclamation from our local state senator, Alan Lowenthal, and they will receive a life pass to all Long Beach City College home athletic events. So they will be given that when they come up to receive their awards. So with that, let's begin with our inductees for this year, and we're going to start off with this individual who was on our track team in 79 and 80. I'm going to take them in the order they're in the program, so if you kind of want to follow along, I'm going to just hit the highlights here quickly. It was a nice Press Telegram article written by Doug Krikorian about Kerry Hardwick this week. He was a track coach's delight. He was quick and versatile. Even though the 800 meters, which he was a Wilson High School CIF champion in, was his strength, he was very good in the 200, 400, and 1500 and on relays. So a coach loved to have an athlete like that that he can move around to earn points. He was on our City College National Indoor Mile Relay record-setting team. Both years, he was all-conference here. He was all-state and all-American. He set the Metro Conference 800-meter record in his sophomore year. After that, he received a full track scholarship to Indiana University, where he helped that school set a two-mile relay record. And just to keep it brief, but keep it real, if you're looking for some outstanding food and jazz, you probably need to frequent Spaghettini's over in Los Alamitos and go up and say hi to the owner, Kerry Hardwick.
I appreciate the plug. Thank you very much. I am so honored to be here tonight. This is really something very special, and totally came out of left field. I got a phone call a few months back from Coach Joe Lanning, who's someone who's very special and near and dear to me, and he told me about this opportunity, maybe, and just the opportunity of maybe being considered to come in here was something that I was quite happy about, to be inducted into the Hall of Champions. Just to be at this dinner tonight amongst everybody that's here, isn't Long Beach great? I mean, really, it's a tremendous community. I look across the room, I see Coach John Meyer, my football coach at Long Beach Wilson, Dee Andrews, track coach at Wilson High School. One of my guests is Coach Eugene Stem from Long Beach Wilson. As it said earlier on, Coach Bob Seymour, I used to play basketball for a couple of years in middle school, and thank goodness Coach Seymour showed me the way, right way. He used to, when I would play basketball for him, I'd be okay on the court, and the second I would do anything around the back or between the legs or something, you're pulled out of there. So anyway, in 1978, I was the CIF champion at Long Beach Wilson, and it was right after the 76 Olympics, and I thought I was going to be the next Bruce Jenner. And after I graduated in Long Beach Wilson, there was no full scholarship offers to me. They had just pulled away a lot of the money for track and field. There wasn't as many scholarships, and the opportunities just weren't there. I was devastated. I was devastated. I had no idea what I was going to do. And I got a phone call from one of my near and dear friends. Les Harris's son, Brad Harris, was the state high jump champion at Los Alamitos, and he called me and said, you know, I'm going to go have lunch with Ron Alice, who's leaving Long Beach State, and he is going to Long Beach City College. You know, why don't you come with us? And he wants to talk about what's going on. And I thank God that that happened, because really and truly, I had lunch with Ron Alice. And for those of you that know Coach Alice, he can sell anything to anybody. But he told us about what he had intended to do, and that was to create a dynasty at Long Beach City College and do something that had never been done and have the greatest track program ever assembled at the community college level. And when I came to that lunch, well, Brad Harris was there, and he was the state champion in the high jump from Los Alamitos High School. And he brought three of the just recently national record-setting mile relay team from Banny High School, who were just three of his people that were coming to Long Beach City College. We put together a team that was unbelievable. And it took a person like me, who didn't have the opportunity for a full scholarship after high school, and put me together with a team that really, I only remember winning everything that we touched in that first year and in the second year. And Ron went on to having 11 state champions and many national champions. And Coach Lanning, just to kind of go back to that dream I had of being the next Bruce Jenner, he was patient with me. He allowed me to try the decathlon, and I learned very shortly that I was not going to be the next Bruce Jenner, but I had some talent for the 400 meters and 800 meters. But the best part that I find about the Long Beach City College program is the way, and it seemed like it was something that was thought out, but now in retrospect, it wasn't, the ability to create opportunity and options for the athletes, the student athletes. And it was wonderful for the programs that we had here, but over the last 20-some years, where I've had the opportunity to have all of the coaches come into Spagatini, the restaurant, and hearing over the years, it's really about the kids and the opportunities that they had. Coach Alice wanted to create this dynasty, but the reason behind the dynasty that he wanted to create was opportunities for his kids. And the hundreds of athletes that Coach Lanning, Coach Alice, and the others on this program, the thing that I would only hear them talk about over the last 20 years when they came into the restaurant was about where these kids were and what they're doing. And they prided themselves in getting four-year scholarships for all their athletes. And our team, we had people go across the nation. And I was fortunate enough that I got a full scholarship to Indiana University. And when I told Coach Alice that, Coach, I was going to sign the letter of intent and go to Indiana University, he got mad at me because I signed it early. Remember I said I didn't have anything after high school. Well, after 2 years at Long Beach City College, I started making visits, and so we started going to the different colleges, and I was home one morning, and the season wasn't over, and I got a phone call from Sam Bell, who was the coach at Indiana University. We hadn't had the state finals yet, and we were all starting to go to our lunches and dinners, and Coach Bell called me in the morning, and no one was home at my house. It was about 7:30 in the morning. I was getting ready to go to class. And he called me up, and he made an offer to me, a half scholarship or something like that. And I said, well, thank you very much. I really appreciate that, but I can't come. I really need a full scholarship to go. And so I was about ready to leave my house, and 5 minutes later, he called me back and said, all right, so if I give you a full scholarship, you'll come to Indiana. And I said, yeah. He goes, okay, you got a full scholarship. So I didn't talk to my parents. I didn't talk to my coaches. I went to school that day and said, I'm going to Indiana University. Well, Coach Alice, the most fun for the coaches on the different teams at Long Beach, but for sure for Coach Alice and his staff, was after the end of the season and creating the opportunities and lining up the different four-year universities and having the athletes be able to pick where they wanted to go. And I robbed Coach Alice and Coach Lanning of that because throughout my second season here, you could tell the way they were working all the universities in the area when they were talking to the coaches. And Coach Alice did. I wasn't an athlete who was world class. I was going to be a decent college competitor, but I wasn't world class. And so what Coach Alice would do with me is he would put me in four relays. And I remember one time he put me in I ran in one day. I ran a 200 meters, a 400 meters, an 800 meters, and a 1500 meters. And on each one of those four relays were horses. I mean, just guys that were great. So we won all four of them. And I got to, you know, play my part in it. And he took me to the sports writers luncheon the next day. But it was all about creating a story or creating opportunities. And so today I'm here with my wife, Joy, and my four children, Kendall, Luke, Cooper, and Presley. They're all athletes, by the way. My son Luke drove all day today. He's on scholarship at San Jose State for cross country. My daughter does lacrosse at Los Alamitos High School. She's a senior. She's currently in the Miss Rossmore pageant. Presley is a hurdler at Los Alamitos High School. And my six-year-old Cooper is a baseball player, and I would be remiss. But they'll tell you, they hear me all the time talk about creating opportunity and leaving options open for yourself and how you do that. And I learned that here at this school. This was the best 2 years of my athletics, and I really appreciate all you that participated in my time at this school before, during, and after, and for being a part of my life. And I thank you. I thank you for that. And I know you're going to keep up the good work. And this program here is something that I just would have had a great time coming to this dinner, even not being honored. But being honored, it's truly one of the greatest things of my life, and I appreciate it for it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Kerry. Our next inductee comes from the sport of volleyball, played here just 1 year, 1980, but he packed a lot in that 1 year before he moved on to BYU. He was the MVP on our conference and state championship team that year. He was the conference player of the year. He was a first-team All-State and a junior college most valuable player. After that, he played on the USA national team. He was a US VBA All-American 14 times. Played professionally in Belgium and Switzerland. I'd say for about 20 years, he was at the top of the world of volleyball. Jack Hinton, would you come forward?
Thank you. I'm thrilled. But I'll make this short, because I'm getting tired. But quickly, real quick, the guys that were mentioned earlier, Bob Myers, Will Shaw, coach, Jim Stanglin, love Marianne, she could beat me in golf, Bob Seymour, and Buck Andreessen, my golf coach, which I didn't put on the resume that I played golf for Long Beach City College. And pretty good, actually. I want to thank Dr. Stetson and his wife for coming a long way to see me. My family, my dad, that's my family, I suppose. Dan Billington, my best friend for thick and thin for 40 years. And Coach Jake. And I'm going to tell you only one story, and I'm not going to be up here very long. Now, all you guys here pretty much are athletes, or student athletes, if you can hear me. Okay, got it. I know, I'm tall. You know, long legs and all that crap. But Jake, you took me in the office in 1980, and you said, son, you got to finish something you start. And so I bit into his program, and we did pretty good in 1980. We got to the state finals championship, and there's eight teams that get there, and we were the number one seed. And we played Golden West. And anybody could have been there, if you could be there, you'd want to be there. We have lost the first two sets, and we are down 9-1 in the third at Pierce College in 100-degree heat. And Jake called a timeout. And he said, rub your legs, guys. It's going to get better. And really, it worked. We beat him 15-9. Then Jake made a brilliant maneuver. He rotated the rotation, if any of the volleyball players that are here, Donna and Margaret and all the people here that are great, you'll understand that he just He changed the rotation where John Perry, my teammate, and Mike Nelson could be in a different position. Steve Hunt was playing back row. He's here tonight. And it worked. We beat them 15-4. So then we go to the fifth set. You know, we got to win the fifth set or we're gonzo. Well, Jake now rotates it back to the original rotation, thinking that the Golden West coach would rotate it three rotations to counteract his fourth set. She did. We beat him 15-3. And we went on to win the state championship. And so quickly, and I believe I was trying to keep it under a minute, Mike Nelson, Kurt Schasker, Walt Shakir, Alan Treffery, John Perry, Steve Hunt, Rick Reeves, and if anybody that I forgot, I apologize. And I am blessed. After that, my volleyball career was worldwide and dynamic, and I saw everything. And I thank everyone here to have to listen to me tonight. And did anybody time me? Thank you very much.
Nice story, Jack.
Thanks.
Here you go.
Well, I get one of those.
Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. That was good.
That was very good.
Well, I didn't want to keep you out here for 80 years.
Oh. I was negligent in forgetting something I wanted to mention when he mentioned Donna Prendle's name. I want to go back, let's back reel to the Bob Seymour Award, how that came about, that plaque with the floor. Came about because when Bob told the story right after that, Donna Prendle and Connie Sears, the women's AD, came up and said, you know what, why don't we do a thing out of the floor that he played on and make a plaque, and my dad, Bud Prendle, who's sitting over there with all of his girlfriends. He's a great woodworker, and he's always been there for Long Beach City College. And so Bud put together that plaque and made that for you, and I wanted to make sure you knew where that came from, Bob. It was a real labor of love. Our next inductee could not be with us tonight. He's unable to attend. I think he's busy in Arizona with spring training. You might know that his son, Bobby, is a shortstop for the Oakland Athletics, so it didn't fall too far from the tree from Ed, who was a shortstop here for a couple of years on two state championship teams that were led by Joe Hicks. He was all everything here, all-conference, all-state, all-American. He was a major leaguer for 6 years. He followed that up as a professional baseball scout. He's really part of the answer to a good Barbette trivia question, and that is, name the community college that has two past players who got into the Cooperstown Baseball Hall of Fame without being inducted as players. Well, one of them's here, and one of them is the guy I'm talking about. The answer to the question is, Greg Harris is in the Cooperstown Hall of Fame because of his glove that he wore when he pitched both left-handed and right-handed in the same Major League Baseball game. And Ed Crosby's name is on a lineup card that was used for the first game that was in a lineup for, I forget who the manager was now. It's in the program there. But he was the first man, black man, to manage a Major League Baseball team, Frank Robinson. And he was on the lineup card, and that lineup card is in Cooperstown. So we've got a couple of unique Cooperstown stories here at Long Beach City College. But Ed could not be here tonight. He sent a nice letter, was very honored, but just wasn't able to attend. So let's have a round of applause for Ed Crosby. Our next inductee comes from the sport of softball. And there's a mistake in the program, which you, if you're sharp, you'll pick it up, which I'm sure most of you will. It's Nikki Trimble, but if you notice there, it's Nikki Kephart, who played Trimble softball. I'm thinking that the printer read all of her accomplishment and just changed the name of the game because, I mean, she was that good. Not only did she lead City College to two consecutive conference championships and two state Final Fours, it's how she did it. She broke every Long Beach City College pitching record on the books along the way. And she set the standards so high that as of today, still, 15 years later, she still ranks first or second in 10 of those 13 pitching categories. So that was an impressive 1993 that she had. She was all conference both years. In her sophomore year, she was the captain, the LBCC MVP. She was another conference player of the year, like Jack was. She played. Her playing days were finished when she went on to the University of Louisiana at Lafayette, where she was a raging Cajun. So let's introduce now Nikki Kephart Trimble.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here tonight. And when I was thinking kind of some of my memories here playing softball, one of my, I guess, kind of funny thoughts is my first year here was when they built the softball field over on this side. And one of Coach Gasso's preseason conditioning was for us, our team, to go out on the dirt field that was there and pick up all the big rocks and throw them aside so that we'd have a nice, clean field. So I'm very honored that that was the first year I was here that I can say I saw that field when it was nothing but dirt. it was also our first year we went to the state championship, so that was quite an honor. And it was also the year I met my husband, so it was a lot of wonderful memories. The 2 years I was here, I was blessed to have so many great coaches, and Coach Patty Gasso will always be held dearly in my heart for her motivation and encouragement, and just she was just a wonderful coach. And I'm just very honored to have the coaches that were here and the friendships I've made, and to be in this room with all these wonderful, wonderful athletes is just an honor. Thank you very much.
That's funny because when I was at El Camino College, they built a new baseball field, and our baseball coach, before every practice, made us line up shoulder to shoulder and walk the infield and pick up rocks. So there must be something about that. Our next recipient is Ernest S. McBride, Jr., a football player and a track athlete. He was a major contributor to our 57 Metro Championship in track and field. He was the second highest point getter that year in dual meets. He was a hurdler and a long jumper. A college publication entitled the LBCC Collegian named him as the college's best athlete that year. In football, he was a top all-around player as a receiver and a rusher on another of Jim Stanglin's Rose Bowl and National Championship teams in 1960. He was drafted by the U.S. Army, and Ernest competed for the 4th U.S. Army at White Sands Missile Range. He was a championship quarterback. He was a championship high hurdler in the Army competition, a long jumper champion. And afterwards, he played football at Long Beach State on one of the best teams that they ever had over there. He later founded the Long Beach Sprinter Youth Track and Field Team to give back to the youth of this city and contribute to our city's track and field. I'm sure many of those young girls moved on to compete here at Long Beach City. Not too long ago, you might remember there was a beautiful article written in the Press-Telegram about his family It was a real tribute to his father, Ernest McBride Sr., for his life's accomplishments and his trailblazing activities. And I understand the family home has been made a historical monument for the city. It appears, Ernest, that it runs in the family. Congratulations. Come on up.
Thank you. Good evening to our honored guests and the other nominees. Congratulations. And I'm still on cloud nine since I got the notice from Coach Lanning. I told my wife, now I don't have to wash dishes or empty the trash for at least another month. And she just told me, well, tomorrow's another day. So anyway, I'd like to kind of give notice. Last year when Coach Lanning called me and told me one of my fellow teammates, Dick Fisher, was inducted in the hall. And the coach asked me, could I come over and kind of represent Dick because he's no longer with us. And so I was able to come to the pre-induction ceremony and say some words about Dick, and then that made me feel real proud to do that. And I'd kind of like to give some accolades to some people that kind of helped me develop to where I am today, you know, during my youth. And I could kind of start out with Helen Irving, who used to run the old California Avenue Recreation Center, which has now been named Ernest McBride Senior Park after my dad. And Miss Irving used to try to teach us classical dancing, like, you know, ballroom dances like cha-cha-cha and the tango and the waltz. And my buddies and I said, Miss Irving, this is really silly for us to be doing this. We should be out there playing. So she told us, well, if you want to improve your technique and your footwork in basketball, baseball, track, and football, say these steps will make you a better athlete. So that piqued our interest. So anyway, and some of the other people that we kind of emulated and tried to help us along was Howie Lyons used to live, who's no longer with us, but he lived down the street from us, and Frank Takahashi, who was an assistant director with Miss Irving, told us to go down to see Howie and he'd give us some tips on basketball. He used to do the famous two-hand set shot that was real great back in that day. And Frank also took us on our first, we won a softball championship in the recreation league, and he took us to our first banquet at a Chinese restaurant over on Anaheim. Although Frank was Japanese, but he took us to a Chinese restaurant, and the food was great, though. And then some of the other athletes that we used to watch and try to emulate, and some of them are in this hall, was Ed Nichols and Clarence Smith and Bill Barnes. We used to watch them play at the rec center, and a lot of us kids, and we picked up a lot of techniques watching these guys play. And then my first exposure to kid baseball was through Al Weiss. He was the fire chief of Signal Hill Fire Department over on Hill and Cherry, and they had a little tackle football team, and that was my first exposure on learning how to play tackle football. In the downtown boys club, had our coach, his name was Lou Castillo, and he taught us how to play organized hardball. They had the old Kid Baseball Association, and so we played for the boys club. And then when I moved on to junior high school, I had coaches like Buck Catlin, Oren Skeeth, and Bill Hicks that taught us a lot of fundamentals. And I eventually moved to Pauley High School, and we had the late Coach Leon Foreman kind of taught us a lot. And then we moved on to Long Beach City here and had Coach Lanning and Bob Humphreys with my coach here in 57 when I ran track. And then in football, Jim Stanglin, Joe Lanning, and Raleigh Eilerts, and Phil Kruger was the coaches that taught us a lot of fundamentals. And then I went on to Long Beach State and had Coach Don Reed, Fred Miller, Stu Farber, and Jim Pullman. And then I kind of like to fast forward a little bit to 1979, where my daughters joined the Long Beach Comets Girls Track Club. And we used to practice right out here on the old field at City. And in 81, 3 years later, we were getting ready to go on a bus tour to Eugene, Oregon for a four-day meet. And we loaded all the equipment on the bus right out here on Lou Davis and got everything set up, and the coach walks up to me and said, Ernie, here's the kids' birth certificates packet and the entry forms, and it's all yours because I quit. And he got in his car and drove off. So I said, oh, my God. My wife there was with me, so we had to go up to Oregon. A lot of the parents were worried. Oh, Mr. McBride, he said, hey, your kid's in good hands, and we'll take care of them. So we went up and had a great meet, come back. So Ron Alice had witnessed this. And the following week, we were out in. He said, well, Ernie, what happened? So I explained it to him. And he said, well, Ernie, you know, you could take over that team, saying we got our equipment here. You can continue to use our field facilities to practice. Here's the key to the equipment shed. And if you need any help or any assistance, we're here to help you. And then standing with Ron was his assistant coach, Earl McCullough, and Baruch Elias, which was one of his field coaches, and Willie Martin was my brother-in-law. And they were all standing there and said, hey, we'll assist you, whatever you need, help you with the kids. So that club, we eventually changed the name to Long Beach Sprinters, but it's still in existence today. So Ron was enabled us to keep that going. And so to kind of finish, my last year here at City, there's probably three individuals that's really responsible for me standing here tonight, because I never had any intentions of playing football in 1960 or running track in 1961. But through the urging and coercement from D. Andrews and Willie Martin, talked me into coming out for the team. And I said, well, I have financial responsibilities that I have to take care of, so I need to work full time. I can't play and go to school and compete. And then in watch Coach Lanning, who is always in my heart. He's been like a surrogate father to me. You know, I love that man. And he came to my rescue and took me over to Uptown Church of Christ, which is over in Bixby Knowles, in 1960. And the people took care of me financially, so you pay us back whenever you can. So I was able to complete my last year here at City and graduate with my AA degree in 61. And then 2 months later, the Army drafted me, and I went into service, and then that enabled me to pay them back. And they said, hey, don't worry about it. Send us what you can. Never had a problem. So what I can say to all of you people here tonight that I mentioned is that I really love you, and thank you.
Can you believe all of that came off of this? I'm amazed. I had a history instructor one time who the main thing was just get yourself organized, and he made us have a piece of paper about half this side, and he said, you can bring this to any exam you want. You just can't get anything bigger than this, so whatever you can squeeze on there. And I swear, I never worked so hard at squeezing information on a little piece of paper to go to an exam. I mean, in earnest, this is great. Thanks for taking us down that memory lane with a lot of great people. That was great. Ron Drake, sometimes the selection committee is amazed that we've not previously inducted someone. This is a case in point. When we were going through his resume of what he'd accomplished, I think we all looked at each other and said, huh? How come so long? Two sports stand out here, football for 2 years, baseball for 1 year. He would have played a second year. I'm sure he went over to SC to get involved in spring football over there and didn't play his sophomore year. That's one of the few ones that Joe Hicks would have lost, but for a good reason. He played on three Long Beach City College teams, and he made three all-conference teams. In football, he set a season and career records in receptions. He did the same at USC. In 1966, he made 52 catches at USC, a record that lasted for 16 years. He became an All-American on Jim Stanglin's 1964 Rose Bowl and National Championship team. In baseball, he was an all-conference catcher drafted in the first round of the amateur draft, but chose to go on to USC and compete, where he was an All-Pac-8 and an All-Coast selection in football. After USC, he was drafted by the Padres and played pro ball for 3 years. This is an interesting one. He played on 3 national championship teams, one here in football, one at SC in football, and one at SC in baseball. He went on to have an outstanding career as a football and baseball coach. He's worked at Mission Viejo High School and Saddleback College as an assistant baseball coach, and he's currently coaching at Laguna Hills High School as an assistant in baseball. Ron Drake.
Well, as you can see, I have a lot of family and friends here tonight. I think we have 4 or 5 tables. Go Trojans, all right. I too am very honored to be here tonight. But I am also, more than that, I feel very humbled to be here. Because you know as well as I know that you're only as good as the people around you. And I had great, great players around me. Players like Earl McCullough, Marvelous Marv Motley, Greg Barton, Al Nichols, and 2 of my real good friends that I went all through high school, Long Beach City College, and USC with, who are here tonight, Reg Fielder and Steve Swanson. I'd like to recognize several people that were major influences in both my career here at Long Beach City and my professional career. First off, I'd like to recognize my mom for being such a great role model for us as we grew up. Thanks, Mom. Now, this one might be a little odd. You might think, you know, why is he doing this? But I'd like to thank my girlfriend when I was at Long Beach City College 45 years ago for staying with me. She's now been my wife of 42 years, and she's still my girlfriend. I also was the recipient of great, great coaching. And it started with my coach in high school. And it was very interesting in the foyer because most everybody here knows him. That's the legendary coach, Ernie Johnson. Ernie taught us. Ernie taught us many qualities as we went through his program. Tradition was very important. Toughness, discipline, and hard work. He taught us the value of hard work, that it doesn't guarantee success, but without it, you really don't stand a chance. And he always told us that, you know, you guys aren't very fast, so nobody better ever be off size, because why would you want to be quick to go somewhere when you're going to get there and be slow? So, Coach, thanks for everything. Out of high school, I came to Long Beach City, and I had great, great coaching led by Coach Jim Stanglin, the head coach. But I had he really wasn't my position coach. He was the backfield coach, and I was a receiver. But he worked with us also. He had John Myers is his name. A lot of people know him in the city of Long Beach. He had great, great energy. Unbelievable. He taught us that, you know, sometimes you're coming from high school, you think you're pretty good. He showed us that, you know what? you're going to have to earn it right here, right now. Nothing is guaranteed and nothing is given to you. I learned a lot from Coach Myers, and I took a lot of it into my coaching career, the enthusiasm, the energy, the positiveness. He always had a great comment for us. Always, you knew he was always in your corner. So, Coach, I appreciate the role model that you were for us. My brother was a longtime coach, head coach at Warren High School. And when I got into coaching, I really didn't know what the hell I was doing. But I would call Randy, and I just have to thank him for all the knowledge that he passed on to me, because I used most all of it. I threw away some of it, and I used most all of it. But my best year in coaching, I've coached 33 years. My single best year was in 1991 when I got to coach with my brother and the legendary Ernie Johnson. And I got to coach my nephew, who was a stud running back for us at Mission Vale High School, Darren. Sometimes you wonder, how did one get somewhere? How did I get to Long Beach City College from El Rancho? Well, Rio Hondo wasn't there. You would think that, and this all did play into it, but the winning tradition, the friends that you had there, the great coaching, that was all part of it. But I'm going to tell you something that sold us. Reggie went to watch Cerritos practice. And he came back and told us, do you guys know they are running 100-yard sprints after practice for conditioning? Well, we started asking around. We had a couple guys from the ranch that were playing football at Long Beach City, Bill Wilsey and Frank Mazzotta. And we asked them, what do they do at City? He says, hey, we run 20-yard sprints and get to take our helmets off. We said, we know where we're going. Right then and there. So we came to Long Beach City, and let me tell you, they were lying to us. That wasn't the case. No. We worked as hard as we've ever worked in our lives. We never let them forget it. One other story I want to tell, and then I'll end, is we were getting ready to play Bakersfield, and D. Andrews about scared me to death during that week. He was telling us that Bakersfield, all their players came out of the Marines. They were 24, 25 years old, and they're going to kick your butt on that field. And I went and told Steve Swanson that. And he says, are you kidding me? He says, that's bothering you? I said, yeah, that's really bothering me. I'm just a little skinny receiver. He says, well, think of this. We're not going up there to fight them. We're going up there to play football. And then I started relaxing. I said, oh, that makes me feel comfortable. All right, we don't have to fight them. I want to thank the Hall of Champions Committee for inducting me. I have many, many great memories at Long Beach City College. And I will always remember this night. Thank you very much. Nice comments. Thank you, guys. Thanks.
Okay, we're moving along here. Laura Fetzner Castro. She came to City College and from Pius, a star in two sports, volleyball and basketball. She's all conference in both sports. In basketball, She was a record setter for career points, points per game. Both years, she was the City College team MVP. Her sophomore year, she was the conference player of the year. And I was told that I could probably get away with this. Just looking at her picture, I would give her the best hair on the team, too. Now, I was told you could handle that, so I'm going to take a chance on that. In volleyball, she was all-conference. Again, she was the LBCC team MVP. She went on to play basketball at Cal State Long Beach in her junior and senior year, and she's living the good life in Palm Springs today. So she'd come forward, Laura Fetzner Castro. Am I okay?
Yes. Is that good, Chris? I'm not holding it. Okay. I apologize in advance for my speech-giving skills or lack thereof. I'd like to congratulate all the other inductees tonight. Okay. Thank you for this opportunity at Long Beach City College. At 18 years old, all I cared about was basketball. That's it. I was completely obsessed. That's it. 24 hours a day. That's all I cared about was basketball. I grew up here. I never thought of myself as a volleyball player. I was a basketball player who played volleyball and kind of turned into a volleyball player, so to speak. A little too aggressive, not real graceful, with a huge fear of falling, which doesn't work at all in volleyball. I'll never forget the day when I finally learned how to hit a volleyball. And poor Karen Gerke, I would not let her leave the gym. I was so deathly afraid that when I left that gym and came back the next day, I wouldn't remember what I did. And I know she doesn't remember it, but I remember it like it was yesterday. And I needed a witness. So Donna Prindle and Karen Gerke, with their perseverance, turned me into a decent center blocker, decent volleyball player, but still a basketball player and a volleyball, you know, trying to make that work. When I first started playing for Donna Prindle, she made me believe and realize I could take it to my next level. This is what's so important about what Donna did for Long Beach City College. She was able to make each player achieve their next level. More importantly, Donna was able to help each player set their own goals and realize their own dreams as she did mine. My obsession grew, as did my drive and my motivation. I always wanted to improve and be my best. We couldn't have asked for a better example than Karen Gerke, because no one was more obsessed than Karen, and we needed somebody to keep those referees in line. I'd also like to thank Bridget Richard, who was equally obsessed. I have so much respect for your leadership ability and ability to keep calm and control on the court at all times. Learning to play together with a group of people with the same goal, when it's done successfully, it just doesn't get any better than that, no matter what you're doing in life. Donna and Karen remained in control of our team. They were also able to rein us in when we turned into a band of misfit toys. Donna, you were always inspirational and able to keep the drive going in our teams. I wouldn't be here today without the support of my parents. My mom, Carol, who's here tonight, always told me to do my best and have fun. Fun is something that should never be lost. Life is too short. And my dad, Dick, who's always supportive and loving and here in spirit, was always there and never far away to remind me not to turn the ball over. I had my own personal cheerleader and my sister, Chris. No matter where we were, who we played, how many people were in the gym, I could hear her over everybody. This past couple of weeks had me thinking of other athletes and fun times we had on the team. We had our resident attorney in Lisa Lawrence. We had Barb Smith, always the engineer. We had Susan Maloney, who was my back half in volleyball because I couldn't play defense. And Francesca Glasscock, just somebody who always made everything complete and fun. And Margaret Boss, I never had the opportunity to tell you, but I always wanted to play with you and never had the opportunity. I know Mary and Emmy are in shock because I made it this far. And in high school, when I was president of my GAA Girls Athletic Association, I made it through one sentence. So I've improved a little bit. And I turned into a sculpture and had to be walked off the stage, and all I could hear or see was Barry Larry laughing on the floor. So I'd like to thank you, my family and friends, for being here tonight. And last but not least, my husband Richard and my son Max, because I wouldn't be the same without you. My most important memories are not of athletics, but of teaching me responsibility, loyalty, teamwork, and friendship. Thank you for helping me grow up. Thank you.
Okay, it's time to buckle up. Five years ago ended this coach's 37 years of teaching and coaching at Long Beach City College. Well, he's still teaching, but as a full-time faculty member. He's another Viking who was hired and influenced by Jim Stanglin. He was a head coach of three different teams, football, men's volleyball, women's volleyball. He was an assistant football coach for 23 years, mainly coaching offensive linemen and linebackers, many of whom are here tonight. He helped lead the Viking football teams to six conference championships, eight bowl games, one state, and one national championship in 1995. He took eight of his 11 men's volleyball teams to the state playoffs. Five of them went to the championship game. Three of them won the championship in 80, 82, and 85. Before his last go-round of coaching in football, he had coached the USA elite female volleyball players, 19 and under. These are young ladies who the country has their eye on as potential Olympians. They turned them over to Jake, and he would take them to places like China, Japan, and Australia to prepare them for future competition. He actually had to walk away from that to come back and finish his football coaching career with Coach Reisbeck. We go on and on and on, but I think I'm just going to bring up Gary Jake Jacobson.
I'm gonna get this up here where you can hear me. I'm honored to be here like everybody else is, and I know you've been here for a long time. And I've been here a long time too. And my football coach in high school was Jim Stanglin, who we had to take home tonight because his back was bothering him, and Matt, my brother-in-law, took him home. I could introduce about 60, 70 people in here right now, and I know that we're getting a little tired and everything, but I'm going to introduce for sure my wife, Diana, 48 years. Stand up, honey. Yeah. That's a good woman. And her sister, twin sister, Elena, sitting at the same table, and she's married to Glenn McFarland, who coach here 30 years. And Mac, you guys stand up, you two, so they can see you. Okay. They're twin sisters. We were really lucky to work together all those years, and he's just like a brother to me. And my family, I want all you guys to stand up back there. Okay, I got four kids and their wives and husbands. And all. Stand up, you guys. There's Karen and her husband, Whit, Breck, and his wife, Andy, Denise, and her husband, Rob. And who am I missing there? Oh, and Kirk over there, and Teresa, he's over there. All right, good family, good group, eight grandkids. They're not here. They're all playing ball and doing different kind of things. I want to start off, though, by before I talk about any players, is that I love football. When I was growing up, in the fifth grade, I got across the street where the high school where I lived, and they were playing tackle football over there, and I'd never seen it before or anything. On my block, we played war, you know, shooting and all that kind of stuff. It was during the Second World War. We didn't even, nobody had a ball or a hoop or nothing. So I went over there, and I watched these guys playing ball. I thought, man, that looks like fun. So I went over there, and those kids lived two or three blocks from me, and I couldn't go over there. My parents wouldn't let me. And they said, you want to play? I said, sure. So they were choosing up teams. Well, I got chose last because they didn't know me at all, and these guys were all better and older and everything else. But it was tackle football, and most of them wanted to score, run, and all that kind of stuff. And so I was a made man because all you had to do was hit them and knock them down. That's next time we chose, I got second in the choice. So I went home that day and said, you know what, I think I like this. And I did. And so my dad let me go over there, and I started playing ball. But I always liked it. And then Coach Stanley came, and we're in high school, and he came from Arizona. Run a tight ship, and my coaches, all of them fought in the Second World War, and they were all disciplined, and I mean, we didn't have any problem knowing right from wrong. I'm going to tell you what, it didn't matter what, I mean, whatever it was, they could take care of it, and we knew what it was. We were laughing earlier tonight, when I was in the 11th grade, Bill Smithern, who's you guys, most of you know here. I don't know if he's here tonight or not, but his dad was the athletic director who hired Coach Stanley. And we were supposed to turn in all our gear, you know, on a certain time. We had supposed to wash it. Well, we had Long Beach, I was at Downey High School, and we had good program. Downey High School football, and we were all proud of those jerseys, you know. We didn't necessarily want to turn them right in on Friday. So I didn't get it in there, and we had a guy named Mr. Freshour, who was the guy that handed out the gear and everything. And so he says, where's your jersey? So I don't know. I smarted off to him. I shouldn't have, but I did. I don't know what I said, but it was wrong. Smithers' dad was walking right down the hallway, and he walks right down to Coach Stanley's office. Kincaid's the basketball coach, the great coach from Cerritos. And Dick Hill, who was the best coach in Orange County for years and years, and put Downey against Anaheim in that big game in the Coliseum where there's 47,000 people. He's my line coach. And he is a tough guy. So anyway, they bring me in. I think I'm a sophomore, actually. It's in the spring. And so Smithers' dad comes down, and he says, you know what? He's down there smarting off to Mr. Freshour. Coach Stanley says, is that true? I said, yes, sir. He said, well, what do you think, Coach Hill? He said, well, they put my head in the locker. They had a big old paddle over there, and it was no problem, man. I had that jersey back in there in about an hour and a half, you know. But things were simple, and we didn't have a whole lot of rules, you know, that kept it from being that way. We had a great program, discipline program, and I loved it. He went to college as a coach and took several of us with him at Orange Coast and went to junior college. Loved junior college, man. I thought, boy, this is just the greatest. We're living down there. We lived in the barracks down there. $40 a month, room and board, all we could eat, play football. Oh, man, we're close to Balboa Island. I mean, we're like died and went to heaven down there. Played, won championships, made great friends. A lot of them are friends I've had all my life. A lot of them are here tonight. And I just want to thank all you guys for all the times we had. Coach Chafe actually is the one that hired me to come here. I had already coached 6 years and was at the University of Idaho. My brother-in-law was already working here for Coach Stanglin, and so they invited me to come back down here. I was down here recruiting some of their guys to go to Idaho, and they offered me a job while I was down there. Well, Coach Chafe is the longevity award around here. He, next to Bobby Myers and Joe Lanning, he's the oldest guy I know, the Chafe. And anyway, he had me come down here and coach with him and everything. And then we coached together off and on a lot of years here. And I coach the offensive line, and he coaches the quarterbacks. When he called the plays here, well, this is really unusual. He called the plays for four national championship teams from starting back in 60, 62, 64. And then when Coach Reisbig was here, all the way to 95, when we came back into football, Coach Reisbig brought us some of the old guys back. And I think that Beverly O'Neill had something to do with that. She told us, get our butts out there. It was time we got this thing rolling. So anyway, he called the plays. Well, the only downside to that is that all those plays stick in that computer up there. And sometimes they get a little crossed up. So one day we're at practice, and he calls his play like he usually does and sends them out. And I'm over to the side, and I listen to the play, and then I'm making sure the defense is set up. Coach Chafe goes over to talk to Coach Reisbig about something, and our quarterback, Neil, this is 95 when his state, the national championship team, he looks at me and he goes like this. I said, and all my players are looking at me like that. So he walks over, I said, what's the problem? He says, Coach, he said, he called such and such. He called such and such a play. We don't have that play. I said, we don't have that. What was the play? I said, oh, yeah. I said, we hadn't had that play since 1980. So I said, he said, what should I do? He said, he called the play. I said, go over there, and I said, just say, check with me, get up to the line, call something different, he won't know the difference. So that's what happened. Sometimes those little computer things get screwed up in there, you know. I had several people when I retired ask me this question. What do you miss about coaching football? Or do you miss coaching? And I thought about it, and yeah, I do miss coaching. But what I miss is not the game and not the strategy. What I miss is seeing those guys every day in that meeting before we go out. Because every day I'd have them for an hour, and we'd be talking about life. We'd be talking about what it takes to get through school. We'd be talking about a lot of things that relate to football, but they weren't actually football. Now, along with that, we were teaching football, too. I'm not saying we didn't. But the thing I remember and the thing I really like was when these guys got scholarships, went on, and one time we did a study, we had 82% of all of our sophomore football players got scholarships, which means they got the grades to get them, and they got scholarships, and they went on. And that's a heck of an accomplishment. And if you look at any of these programs they got around here, you can see where all these guys went to school. I got some guys here that come down, and some of them one of them came with his wife from Alabama for this meeting. And a lot of those guys have traveled a long ways. And I want you guys on the football bunch back there, the offensive lineman, stand up here so these guys can see you. Now take a look at these guys, huh? How'd you like to feed them every night? Okay. That's a great bunch of guys. Two of those guys were tackles in our 92 and 93-94 team. We won 18 games, and they never, with those two tackles playing every snap. And during that time, they had one sack between them, and neither one admitted to who had the sack. But that was a great bunch. And the rest of those guys, 1995 national championship team, the offensive line, those guys were on it, and they're really super guys, and they're from all over, and they came to this thing. I'm really happy about it. Another thing is Ken Gregory is our wide receiver coach, and for years, And he was a volleyball coach. He got volleyball started here about 1972 or something like that. And I was a head football coach until 76. And I got out of football for a while. And he said, why don't you come over here and help me coach the volleyball team? I said, what? He said, why don't you come over? He says, you're not doing nothing. Come over here and help me coach the volleyball team. So I said, gee, many Christmas. So I got to thinking about it. He probably needs somebody to drive the other bus or something, you know. I didn't know anything. So I went out there with him for that first year. And man, they had some players. And they had some guys from Hawaii. He'd done a great job recruiting. I knew that part. And I watched these guys play, and they had a good team. And we went and played BYU up there, and they paid our way up there. And he had a great team. And I'm watching this, and I couldn't believe it. And this is a lot different than the volleyball I remember. And so at the end of the year, he decides to be a counselor, and he goes over there, and they want me to be the coach. Oh, man, I said, I can't be the coach. I don't know that much about this. He said, oh, yeah, you'll do fine, you know. So Beverly O'Neill, she wasn't the head person there at the time, but, you know, she said, you ought to do this. Of course, they just wanted somebody to do it. Somebody had to do it, right? So it may as well be me, you know. I mean, I was already out there, and they wanted me to be busy kind of deal. So so I wrote up all these conditions, you know, the reason this is how I'm going to take this job. If I'm going to take this job, I'm going to get something out of it for the kids, right? So I said, okay, look, I'll take this job, but we got to have new uniforms. We had a horrible budget. I don't know. Donna would know. We had no money at all. So I submitted all these things. I'll take this. Okay, and what I didn't want to do is if I didn't like it, maybe I wouldn't be very good at it. Well, they'd be real upset if I say, hey, I'm not going to coach this anymore. You know, then what are they going to do? So I sent it to Beverly O'Neill, and Riley Ayers was the AD. Well, she sends it back, and she says, I can't honor this. He's telling me what he's going to do. You know, we're trying to hire him here, you know. So she says, the board won't take care of this, accept this letter. Let me write the letter, and then he can be the coach. Okay. So she writes the letter. Well, it was a perfect letter if it was from the administrative person would write it, right? It was a two-page letter, said nothing. Talked about a lot of things, but had nothing to do with what I wanted to do. But anyway, I became the volleyball coach. Well, then I got these guys over here. There's a bunch of them here tonight. And, I thought, first of all, that we were going to have these freshmen back. Okay, all these guys were freshmen. They all got scholarships. Four of them went to USC and won a national championship the next year for USC. And one of them went to UCLA. So we got all the guys we got, none of them played but one. And they got a rookie coach. So I remember the first day I had them in a meeting, they're sitting there. And I said, all right, you guys, look. You guys all know the situation here. I haven't coached very much volleyball. And I said, you guys hadn't played very much volleyball. And I said, I don't want anybody whining. At the end of the year, we're going to go out there and we're going to work our butt off, and I know how to win. So and I know what players look like. And we made the playoffs, went on through. They're good guys, all worked hard. We didn't have volleyball in town, so I got guys that had played some other sport and were big, you know, yeah. And that's it. Basketball, yes, okay. Soccer, no, okay. But they worked their cans off, and I remember I was in there telling them, look, I don't want anybody whining. I'm telling you right now, I don't know that much about it, but I'm going to find out. All right, so we go out there, and we manage to win a lot of games and still get in the playoffs, and we don't win the thing. And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, I'm signed on for this deal, and I don't know very much. So I got a hold of Al Skates, who was the best coach in the world at UCLA. And he had recruited one of our guys, one of Kenny's guys, not my guys. And I said, Coach, I said, I need some help here. You know, I said, and I said, can I come up to your place and just watch you coach? I said, if I can just watch you coach, you don't have to tell me nothing, say nothing, you don't even have to talk to me. Just let me come in there and watch you. So I went up there for 2 weeks during Christmas between 1979 and the next year. And the next year, and we learned a lot, really learned a lot. Next year we win the state championship. Of course, we get Hinton. I made some guys play that were out of my club. They were guys that were in this fraternities over here, and they were big. I said, all right, this is Hunt Price. You guys are playing. I said, coach, we don't even know. I said, well, I don't know either. We're going to go over there and play. 1-6-7, you know, and can play basketball. He could have made our basketball. And guys, good. So we win this. We win it all. And from then on, it took off, and God bless me. That's all I can say, because I was definitely not the great candidate. But which they'll tell you. But I can tell you what I know about meeting with kids. You can't coach them unless they trust you. And they can't. They have to trust that you're going to do the best for them, and you got to trust that that they want to be a great player. If they'll do that, then we can get. When we walk to that field, they're ready to go because they've told me they want to be a great player, whatever that means, the best they can be. And they know I'm going to be there for them, and I'm going to be the same every day. And you ask those guys, I'm the same every day. And we go in there to get something done. And we got a lot done. And in football, and I'm grateful for all the football coaches that are in here. There's probably 27 of them over all these years. And I was going to introduce them tonight, but we're getting a little late in the day. And I'm grateful for them all. And thank you guys for coaching with me and for everything that the city. And I'm glad to be a Viking.
Go, Jake. If I can have all of the inductees come forward, please. The eight that were inducted tonight, we're going to have our installation, and this is a good photo op if somebody wants to get a picture of the group, and we'll conclude the evening. But if all of our eight inductees tonight come up, Chris, you'll get a good photo, and whoever wants to jump in behind Chris here and get a photo of everybody, just gather right up here in front, guys. And so I'm going to read this official proclamation. It gives me great pleasure on behalf of Long Beach City College to officially install each of you in the class of 2009 into the LBCC Hall of Champions. Congratulations. Thanks for everyone attending.